Well, let me introduce the next speaker, who is Stewart Kellett from British Cycling. He's Director of Recreation and Partnership, a position very much a legacy, created as a legacy of the Beijing Games in 2008, precisely with the view to make the most of mega events and bridge the gap between elite and mass participation. So, Stewart, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Basil. It's starting to feel like an endurance event, this, isn't it? It's so hot. Could be in Beijing right now. Simon, it's a shame you didn't speak to me beforehand because I have a solution to your environmental impact. Everybody arrives to an event, it's so obvious.
It's not the first time, I think.
Sorry?
The best of time.
Yeah. I'm ready to go, that's good. So, what I'm going to do is squash 6 years. Oh, you're going to play me now?
Whenever you say.
So I'm going to try and squash.
No.
Let's get to the video.
Shall we go for the video?
I'd rather introduce you first. Is that all right? Yeah. Right. Start again tonight. Yeah. I'm going to try and squash 6 years of work at British Cycling. Really, I'm busting some myths around the Olympic legacy. I remember, actually, it was the 6th of July 2005. I worked for Sport England at the time, and when we were on the right to host a home Olympics in London. I remember being interviewed, and the first question was, there's no evidence that this will make a difference to the UK's participation. And I've been hounded with that question for ages. So there's a chance now to sort of bust on those myths, because I think the work we've done at British Cycling with Sky, with Sport England, and a whole new workforce at British Cycling that see things a little bit differently now, we've managed to do a lot of the things which we've been talking about here, and the very speakers and the research has been done. I think this puts a spotlight on a really interesting case study about how it can be done. It's not a perfect execution, but it's a pretty good go at making the most of the home Olympics. So let's excite the room first. Let's get into a video and show some highlights.
Robin Higgins becomes Britain's first Tour de France champion. To all to carry from a new way,
always puts fire in your belly, that, doesn't it, when you see a great video? And it's been quite difficult for governing bodies to capture elite success and sustain that and actually deal with mass participation, grow the grassroots sport. Trying to do the two together is really, really difficult. We found it really tough. But we've got evidence now to prove you can do both, and I'm going to give an insight into how that's been done. Cycling is in a completely different environment, and we face different challenges compared to other sports. But at the same time, there's loads of lessons and clues in this about how anyone in a governing body environment, or indeed any other kind of functioning environment that promotes sport, relates to consumers, creates behavioural change, you can get a stack of ideas from what we've done. And I'd be very happy to talk to people after or as a follow-up if you want to know a bit more about what we've done and how we've done it. So I joined British Cycling in 2009, just as B Sky B signed up a deal to, crazy idea really, get a British winner to ride the Tour de France, which was unthinkable at the time, and also an amazing aspiration to get a million people into cycling. And various cynics saying it can't be done, it's a stupid thing to do, it's never been done before, and actually participation's flattened, so why would it happen? And at the time, British Cycling, having had a brilliant Beijing Olympic, decided that, you know what, with the attention of the nation, and more interest from the government and people who can influence sport, looking at British Cycling, the board at British Cycling decided that they should take more responsibility because they can direct that resource, that profile, that winning gold medals regularly, and the reputation you get. We decided that we should do much more for society. It sounds very cheesy, but looking at things like promoting cycling for the health of the nation when there's an obesity crisis in the country, seemed the right thing to do ethically and for our business and for growing the sport long term. So it made total sense. So we're in a unique position now where we're not just governing the sport, but we're shaping how cycling operates in this country, the environment, the political influences, the infrastructure and the people that want to get involved. And it's really about normalising cycling. There's a colleague here from Amsterdam. We're never going to quite get to that dizzy high, I think, because of the culture and the kind of population densities. But there's loads of things that happen in other countries that we're taking pieces of and building in, not just as a governing body, but a responsible organisation that can do a lot for cycling and people in this country. So we moved from winning bike races to this inspiration to participation theme, using international success to reach out to so many more people and use cycling for many more reasons in terms of economic, health, social benefit. And transport comes to the fore around infrastructure, emissions, environmental issues and health as well. So we completely diversified into new markets. And we aligned that sort of broader ambition with the 2012 ambition specifically, so that the two are linked. We're aligning them rather than saying this is what the organisation does and we'll try and do something a little bit out of the ordinary with the Olympics. So we wanted to achieve a lasting legacy of participation, but given that no one had done it before, how are we going to do it? And the elite success was tricky because the rules in London changed about one rider, one race, rather than multiple riders for one category of racing, so we were up against it there. We predicted the growth, but we didn't have the capacity to meet that, so we had to think really clearly 4 years ahead, not the year before, not 6 months before, but 4 years ahead. How do you create the capacity when the volume ramps up and more people want to play your sport? How do you get all the right people in place to give people a brilliant experience? And if you want new people to come into your sport, that first touch point in your sport has got to be brilliant. Be it online, be it the experience, be it the coach, the volunteer, the equipment, it's got to be brilliant. And in sport we've not been brilliant, but you've got to be brilliant on first touch contact with new customers. And we thought that the whole 4-year plan leading to Olympics would change the perceptions of British Cycling. We're not just people in Lycra winning events, we're an inclusive organisation that cares about everybody in this country to get on a bike. And it needs foresight, because the cynics kept saying to me when I joined British Cycling, people outside the organisation, this can't be done, it needs lots of resource, why are we skewing resources over here? It could be doing other things just for the sport. And we took a view that no, that's not good enough. We need to commit to a much broader footprint to get people into our sport. Now, part of this was taking the staff with you, because it was generating this self-belief. Your team of people need to go with you. So if you think back to the year before the Home Olympics, before 2012, so October time, 2011, and I took my whole team through this. I'm not going to say anything for the next 2 minutes. The room was completely dark. I can't open the room now. It was completely dark, and I played this back to people to get the mindset. Because if you do the same thing all the time, you're going to get the same results. We needed different results. So here we go. So I took my team through that. It was in a darkened room. People got very excited. We played the video. We got various speakers in. We had the team stand up and talk about what was going to be their commitment. And that day, the mindset changed completely. And the fact that we'd been doing it for 3 years, creating awareness and reaching new people, meant that the whole team in British Cycling felt very, very different. And if you think about the images on the video, what we managed to do is get a lot of athletes accessible for mass participation, bike rides, through video content, through appearances, through questions and answers, through the athletes actually fronting the emails themselves and acting online. So we had an awful lot of interaction where athletes were very accessible. And the fact that they turned up for our mass participation program and rolled with ordinary people from local areas and towns and cities was pretty amazing. So we built this connection well before the Olympics. And the mistake that we all keep making is we leave it to the Olympic point, it all gets pretty hectic, and then we go, the legacy starts here, and it absolutely doesn't. The legacy starts at least 4 years in advance, in my opinion and my experience. I've talked to many governing bodies in Britain, and they've tried a lot of this, but they've tried too late. What did help was having BSkyB as a communication partner. So the communication element and the way you execute this, particularly more so now going forward digitally, is absolutely key. So if you've not got a great marketing campaign, a big communication partner, you're up against it. And if you're not great on digital now, you're going to be up against it. So not the only reason, but two big clues there about how you capitalise on this. So that was our ambition. And we set some pretty big objectives, as I mentioned, about Tour de France, continuing success, London and Rio. We're thinking of some new angles for Rio going forward. We're pretty well practiced on this now. I'm not saying it's going to be easy, it's a different continent, and we've lost that big home field, but there's a way of regenerating, refreshing that feeling in London we got, and a way of connecting to Rio. With this horrendous target of 1 million people on a bike by 2013, we've repeated that, we're very close to our second million. We had a once a week target, people coming into the sport, which we signed up with our lottery fund and sporting with our partners, and we've been smashing that as well, because we've moved people from once occasional cycling into regular cycling. And we had a membership target of 100,000 when it had been stuck at 15,000 for years. We'll talk about that a bit later. And back to the point about the brand, we wanted to change the perceptions of British Cycling's brand. We were just not a governing body about winning, we were going to be about cycling for all people's interests going forward. So telling the story about how you're making this more accessible to people as you go was really important to change people's views of our brand. And the tricky bit, and that's what's good about connecting with perhaps academics today and the research that Basile and Nikolai have done with input on governing bodies and people like yourselves, is some of this is a bit of leap of faith because we haven't really codified these things very well yet. And we've got a small kind of research and analytics team in my department where we pulled an awful lot of intelligence together before we spent our resources on it. We really had to think about it. And in doing it, we set up a hypothesis. We said, what are the conditions during the Olympic Games that are going to make this work for us? So this is the book we put together some years ago now, 2009. So it's going to be the best free marketing campaign you could ever wish for. You've got to use that. Don't sit back and not use that. Crazy. And when the British athletes win, the public in the UK are so malleable. Sam might have some different views about that. But our experience is they're very, very malleable. When British athletes win a medal, they are giddy. They can be persuaded to do lots of things. And because we lined up the awareness before these athletes won medals, people were very familiar with how to get on a bike, the programs at British Cycling, how accessible it was, they liked the brand. The brand familiarity went up massively. They knew where to go. When an athlete won a bronze, silver, gold, they were on TV saying, I hope this inspires a lot of people to get on the bike. Then I queued up for an interview, talked about what was happening locally. The web spikes went through the roof every single time that happened. We did 25 live interviews every single day during Olympic Games. We did over 100 regional interviews every week. And every time we did it, there was a familiarity in Britain that went straight to the website, that went on a bike ride. Brilliant formula. So we knew that inspirational point, people would contemplate getting involved in bike riding, but they'd done the contemplation well before the Olympics. Your point there, Sam. So behavioural change takes time. You know, because you're all familiar with the behavioural change models. You can't just get someone to flick into the Olympic to your sport when they see someone win a medal. It won't happen. So we had to prepare massively. We did forecasting models on demand on a 20, 40, and a 50% uplift in demand. We put capacity in place, and it was agile enough to move across programs and marketing to tap into that. And on the way in, we had other British Cycling goals. We wanted to leverage commerciality, get more fans, get more members, and so on. So it wasn't just about participation. So this is a bit of a mood curve, just to sort of take a little bit of a side about the kind of shaping of things. These spikes here are kind of the level of optimism that we found in cycling. And in, I think in general in the country, really. So London Bid announcement, Beijing Games, run Olympic build-up, with some cynicism I might add. Big Spaniard 2012 look. Opening ceremony. Games twin spike on Olympics, Paralympic competition. And then it's probably a bit steep here, but it did go on for some time, probably until about December that year, when it was the BBC Sports Personality Year Awards, where Brad Wiggins won Sports Personality, Dave Brailsford won Coach of the Year for the second time, and it was three athletes from cycling that won that award within 5 years. So the whole profile and success had really put the spotlight on cycling, giving us a chance to talk to many, many people. But just thinking forward now, you know, it does dwindle in terms of the interest, but it's what next for Rio? It'd be interesting what governing bodies are doing for Rio, because it's another continent, it's not going to be as important. It's still the biggest event on this planet. It's still got huge potential. And if you've been good at it in London, there's a pretty good chance you're going to be good at it in Rio in terms of leverage and participation, and we're gearing up for that massively. And I think the media doesn't help. I think the media create this mood. Think about the cynicism about, oh, great, we've won the bid, what does that mean? There's no legacy. Oh, we've won lots of medals, but what about the cost of a Hobb Olympics? So all the time you're dealing with the positives and the cynics. And you've got to deal with that in terms of how you pitch your effort into this work, how much you want to spend on this, and take, for some people, a big gamble, for others not. So this whole thing around inspiration to participation was born in 2009, and we've played with that theme ever since, and we still use it. The advantage with cycling is, at some point, you'll have all have ridden a bike. As a kid, recently, whatever, just your bike off from a shed, you'll have all got involved. So there's something in your head already. If we get the right buttons pressed in your head about the emotional connection, that good feeling, thinking about doing it, and we make it easy for you to ride a bike, there's a pretty good chance we'll get you involved in riding. And we've got evidence that people move into the sport quite quickly now. So we use this as the model, and it takes time. And we've got a lot of people before the Olympics in this zone and participating. And then when you find these buttons, you can kick them into regular participation. And it's a bit like Salmon's model, where he's saying new people won't just dive into the activity, it'll take a long time. Well, we did the prep before the Olympics itself. And we repeat that cycle with different customers. This is our operating model. We had a completely different view. Rather than just take the traditional cycling activity, we knew there were loads of barriers to get involved in cycling. So we just pretended there was no cycling activity and thought, well, what are the things that people want? What are the kind of cycling activities people want going forward? And we changed our language. With Sky, it was not cyclists, it was consumers. So we looked at what do people want? How are people motivated? And what are the barriers to get involved in cycling? And what should our response be? And it was very different than your current standard cycling club. Because it was some are too difficult to get into because they're too fit and the image is not appropriate. Some clubs are brilliant at it, but generally it was not good enough in terms of access. So what we've done is create some new offers. We've done it a different way with different routes to market. We actually have different channels to reach people. And what's happened in the last 6 years is that the clubs have moved a lot. Cycling clubs have moved a lot to actually get more inclusive, and their membership have shifted. So they've moved their offer, in addition to British Cycling creating new offers for people to get involved in cycling, probably the first time for years. And we've got this strategic cycle now, where based on our vision, we have great insight, we have great responses, cleaner routes to market, we can reach more people. We've got an operations team that go into massive detail to make sure everyone's experience is brilliant. And we track every single person's experience. So we do a rider rating, we do a volunteer rating, and we do it every single week. So we have real-time data on every activity on a weekly basis. And if you ask another sports organisation how often they collect data and track their customer reaction, it's probably not weekly. Might be annually, don't know. Some are getting better at that. There's several governing bodies that invest a lot in insight recently, and they're moving into this territory of regular performance tracking, looking at the behaviour of people in your sport rather than just look at attitudes and look at your current programmes. So then we hatched this model. This is the behavioural change model, really. This is a national campaign called Skyride. Dead simple, single call to action. If you're inspired, when Chris Hoy won that medal, inspired, they already knew to go to goskyride.com. They go to goskyride.com, simple way to get involved in three things. The research told us, keep it really simple if you're new to cycling. A great experience at a mass participation bike event, a festival, a fun thing, it's outdoors, three generations. Nine grander, mum and dad and the kids. That kind of feel. Entertainment. Brilliant. Great experience. Get the data, find out what they want, and send them information about the next step opportunities to get involved in cycling. It's not that difficult. You just need to think about how you're going to do it, put the process in place. People wanted local guided rides. People didn't know where to ride in their area. People thought, well, I'm going to go straight on the main road. I don't know any good routes. So we trained 3,500 people up. We mapped some brilliant routes, we still do, across the whole of Britain, and we take people on guided rides to give them that first step up into regular riding. And we found that's morphed now. People actually want to organise their own rides, they've got confidence, so we've got an online tool where people can organise their own rides, post a ride, and get people involved. So it's dead easy. You come to the website, three easy ways of doing it. Because it's registration based, we have all the consumer data. And we're now segmenting them into 17 segments. 2009, there was 5 segments, now there's 17. So we know about the pattern of behaviour when people get involved, which means when we talk to them, we give them a better opportunity to carry on bike riding. And the delivery model had 7 key facets. I'm not going to go through them all, but they're the kind of basic fundamentals that we went through to make sure that this worked beautifully. Really well-oiled machine that got people into cycling and stayed in cycling. And then this thing about insight, we knew that there was potential to grow. So we weren't creating this proposition thinking there's no latent demand, there's no demand for this sport. Why would you spend millions of pounds on something where there's no demand? We were really clear about latent demand. And our currency is in three levels of cycling, really, sort of less than 12 times a year, at least 12, and then once a week. We're trying to bring new people in, and the people that are a little bit hesitant to bring into regular, the people regular into the sport. We've got this funnel that we're tracking all the time about how people move into the sport, into the activity, into fringe sport, into the sport itself. So you've got to dissect that. It's a very crude dissection because there's 17 segments through every single layer of that. But just to give you a quick overview, we knew about the headroom, massive headroom. And we researched, on those occasional regular and frequent cyclists, we researched the barriers. And we looked at their motivations, and we created a very unusual mass participation programme. For people who cycle a bit more often, slightly different barriers, slightly different motivations, we created a lead ride. And the same for people who are regular. So they all want different responses, and these are people probably not even in the club yet. So really, something well below what British cycling used to do. This is pre-club environment. So we assembled a new team, and it was around these things, and Sky influenced us a lot about customer service. And we looked at how they split their subscription customers and how they talk to them. And we weren't talking about cyclists because really we're talking about new customers. So we want to talk to them as a consumer and their interests and their motivations. And we produced very different people in the organisation to look at these things and be really good at it. So it's a whole new competence that British Cycling brought together. And we grouped them into these functions, 5 functions. And every single function is interdependent. And the backbone of it, which people here will be delighted with, is this. So before we do anything, we need to be really clear, what are the chances of success? What is the read into the environment, internally and externally? How responsive will customers be if we promote this cycling offer? And then all the operations and the routes to market kick in. Really good structure, very different than a traditional governing body. In terms of competencies, we have this brilliant registration-based website. You go on the homepage, 3 places to go, including a postcode finder. You'll find a plethora of rides where you live, organised, self-organised, or a big bike event. It's a great experience. But in Tour de France time, we dress it up. We get athletes involved, they get talking on video. Next week, we'll be painting it yellow. And during Olympics, we painted it patriotic. But these are things that people relate to. And we had Chris Hoy's spokesperson as well throughout the campaign, along with Brad Wiggins, and we had Laura Trott and other top female cyclists chipping in at different intervals, all to mix this up about the messaging. but they were so good because we briefed them all about what this mass participation problem was about. So it's no accident that most of the athletes, when they were talking about the performance, kept saying, and I hope this inspires a lot of people in Britain to get on the bikes. They kept doing it. It was absolutely brilliant. And this is one of our sky rides. I think it might be Leeds actually last year. So you can see Ben Swift and Brad in the background looking quite happy there, I think. But they all contributed to the mass participation. Bringing them into this mass participation contact with ordinary people is so important. This is about positioning. So if you imagine all that going on and lots of interest, athletes profiling really well, the media interest, the success we've had, this behavioural change, awareness in advance. We knew that if we position this, because cycling is pretty unique about it, presses lots of social, economic, environmental buttons. So we positioned this in different ways in government to influence them, saying cycling has an awful lot to do with a range of government departments. So policy-wise, it's really important because we do many things for the well-being of this country. And local government were key in that as well. So we're positioning cycling a different way so it produces a different outcome depending on which partner wants to invest in British cycling. It's so powerful. And just before the Olympics, we pulled together a study. No one had done a really comprehensive economic impact, and we thought there's an economic button here to press, which has never been pressed for cycling. And at the time, we found it was virtually £3 billion, the economy, and the industry had never quantified it. So we used that as a huge PR element to get the attraction of many, many potential investors, and the industry loved it as well. It put cycling on the map in terms of economic relevance. And when you do that, you suddenly get leaders involved. So Boris Johnson, Mayor of London was, all mayors in big cities are synonymous with cycling, usually. You think about the Mayor of New York, Amsterdam, Copenhagen, Boris Johnson. So you influence those people, things start to happen. And then you get further influence because, whoa, what's going on here? We're affecting lots of communities, there's so much profile. So we've managed to position the work we've done at a higher level to get politicians to talk to us about, this is pretty special, what else can we do with cycling that makes a bigger impact in the UK? So that's the positioning that you can do if you leverage participation, but it was always linked to Olympics, because politicians were looking, you know, who has got the answer to legacy? They wanted an answer, and we wanted to find that solution with them. So this is about being greedy, but it's more than participation. We wanted overall market growth in cycling. We wanted to increase that frequency because you've got to get people more sticky. If they're fringe cyclists, if it's once, it's occasionally, you never really get sticky. You'll drop off it. You're a fair weather cyclist. You can't bother to take your bike down. You need frequency. You need a habit-forming opportunity. The churn's interesting. People drop out of cycling. If you have a 2% dropout of once a week cycling, and it's 400,000 people over a four-year period, that's pretty disabling when it comes to actually increasing the participation rate in your sports. So churn, keeping people in cycling is key. British Cycling wanted to increase the market share, as in their influence on the market needs to be greater to shape it, not just participation, but competition as well. Despite all this uplift I'm talking about, the disparity between male and female cycling was still really big. Three times more men cycle than women, and we decided that was not good enough. And before the Olympics, pretty bravest, before the Olympics, the Hobby Olympics, we actually said, it's going great, we're poised for a good time Olympics, but we're not very good at attracting women into the sport. We did an online poll just before the Olympics. It was a really brave move. But hey, you admit to your weaknesses, people respond. And we had, I think, over 3,000 responses online for women suggesting loads of ways to make the sport and make cycling more accessible. We've built on that. We've now got a 2020 aspiration to get 1 million women on a bike. So that's an example of being brave and opening yourself up, getting feedback and acting on it. We wanted a better campaign. Every year we shot the campaign up I'm talking about. The customers wanted better quality all the time. They want more. We wanted to improve the brand position. And at the point where it was maybe, well now really, a couple of years after the Olympics, we knew we were looking for other sponsors, and we knew that the whole Olympic effect might be dwindling, so we need some conditions to sustain this great growth that we've produced. So with all this inspiration, the programmes, and the better infrastructure of people and opportunities to ride in place, we're doing pretty well. So if you look at the medal total, some amazing performances which are still sustained. Got a bit of a challenge in Rio, but the intention is to sustain that. And then beyond the Olympics, we've got successes in all kinds of competition across six cycling disciplines, not just about track and road, there's four other disciplines as well. And the trend around participation in upper muscular groups is really, really healthy. If you did a line of best fit on that graph, the trend is really, really healthy. Against the backdrop of other sports, perhaps struggling a little bit, we're in a really, really good place. And look at that Olympic year growth. Absolutely phenomenal, as Simon said on his previous graph, but it's sticking. We had a bad winter just after it, and it's going up again, but another wet winter. But the trend is really, really healthy. Now then, this is an independent metric. Every year we do a survey of 40,000 people through an independent company, and they ask the question, have you been influenced by skyriding? It's a campaign to get people on bikes. Have you been influenced to ride or ride more often? And the target for 2016 is 2 million. We're at 1.7 now, this one here. So this is the growth, the net growth. This is the growth per year, and this is the churn. So these are people we lose, these are people we gain. And it's a tough survey because we also say, have you stopped cycling? That batch of people we talk to, if they stop cycling, they're part of the churn, they come off the list. So that's a pretty tough metric, that. So we've sustained the growth since 2012. We've influenced an awful lot of people to get involved, and we've got to stop. We've got to get people cycling more often, which is a little bit at odds with what Sam was saying about the movement generally. The mood, I think, in Britain about we need to attract new people to it. Totally agree. But you've got to get the weighting right. You've got to get people, keep people in your sport if you're going to be successful. We want to be increased our market share, so we now influence 40% of the cycling market. Remember that there's a ton of people that ride a bike that don't get involved in cycling, which is fine. But more and more, we want to shape the market. There's a lot of commercial distortion coming in, lots of people from other countries want to come in and put on events. It can distort the competition structure. There's an issue about how we optimise the investment in the country as well. We've started to break the back of female participation. I mentioned the weakness we announced just before the Olympics. 2 years on, we've started to address that, and we've just increased participation by 250,000. And we've got a really stiff target at 2020. Now, this picks up the research from various people who've spoken already, really nicely, I think, about campaigning. So the Skyride campaign, which is the longest standing sports participation campaign probably in Britain ever, it's been going for 6 years with two more years. And it was all about, on the left-hand side, creating awareness and the contemplation to ride a bike. And the awareness and contemplation came out of Team Sky, the British Cycling Sky Partnership, the programme called Skyride, and there's a few other things that we've done around that which actually prompted people to think about it. But it's mainly through a promotional campaign which was about awareness and building the brand connection. And you can see here that through the campaign, people involved in the 1.7 million, 78% were aware of the campaign directly, and it influenced 38% to actually ride. But what I'm saying here is you need the programs. It's not just a campaign to promote. You need physical things that they get involved with to touch the sport, to get involved. So when we actually put the programs on, like a Skyride event, a go ride event for the children, a local led ride, we've got a tool called Ride Social, which is self-organized events, and we introduced a women's only program called Breeze. That influenced 62% of the people involved in the 1.7 million to actually get on a bike. So you need campaign and you need local accessible programs, and the two together work beautifully, not one or the other. If I work for another governing body, the first thing I'd do is say, consider your market and think about a big communications campaign, but make sure that the actual touch point is brilliant and accessible. Fairly basic principles, but we just don't do enough of it. Right, this is really interesting now. So this is the Olympic, a combination of the Tour de France and the Olympic month, 2012. And so we've got visits to the website on a daily basis, thegoalscarrier.com, this is the registration-based website, picking up the campaign. You're inspired, single call to action, goalscarrier.com. Two clicks, you've got your local ride. You're cycling, simple as that. So you've got your spikes of visits, and then you've got your registrations to actually physically commit and go on the bike ride. And you can see these spikes connecting really well. Interestingly, the biggest spike was when Bradley actually won the Tour de France, but I mean, that was something special. So was the Olympics, but to get a British rider win the Tour de France was seen as like the French winning Test cricket. It's that kind of bizarre situation, but it happened. So there's absolute connected proof that when our top athletes win medals in a major event or Olympic setting, and you've done all your behavioural change preparation, building up for 4 years, they're totally aware of what it is. They're not thinking, what is Skyride, what's a local bike event. They know what it is. They're into participation. They're not into contemplating, they've done that, they're into doing it. So that is a beautiful graph on underpinning everything I've told you so far that says it works. So pleased I managed to get off my chest. I've been waiting 6 years to tell you that. And this touch point is really, really good, because if you've got a trained workforce that gives people a really good experience, people don't have to keep coming on these programs to ride a bike. They're equipped to do it on their own. You can get on a bike now and start around the university. You don't need any help if you're confident enough. What was really good is that people who weren't cycling very much, once they had an experience, they went on, 7 out of 10 went on to cycle more often. And if you were riding once a month, 9 out of 10 went on to cycle once a week. That is the holy grail for governing bodies. If a governing body sport created a single experience for their sport and said, 9 out of 10 people on this program will definitely go on to do more, win it. And that's where we are. And that ratio continues. It's absolutely phenomenal in terms of results. This thing about data, this is just a snapshot. We have all the data, because it's all digitized, everything comes in every week. I have a brilliant team of people who pull this together for me. And all the managers get this report. This is just a snapshot. There are about 200 other pieces of data analyzed underneath all this. But basically, we're monitoring total registrations, the conversion rate. Look at this. If 1 in 10 people came to your website, I think it's the university here, if 1 in 10 people came to the university website and signed up for a course, you'd be very happy. If you're a governing body, 1 in 10 go to your website and actually participate in the sport, you'd be very, very happy. Next online, I think they indexed about 6%. So we're pretty happy with that conversion rate. It's phenomenal. How many governing bodies monitor that? I'm not sure. Worth monitoring that. We're actually performance managing databases and database opting. We need more rich data, we need the right data. We're measuring throughput. And then underneath all that, we're measuring service. So for example, we're measuring the ride rating. Everybody on our program gets asked a couple of simple questions and they rate the ride. So after 6 years, our average ride rating is 8.9. So these are phenomenal statistics. And what happens is this all gets put back into the different teams I mentioned earlier, and they put the spotlight on the weaknesses and they attack the weaknesses to keep the ratios and the performance targets up. I shared this with Vasil and it was pretty detailed, so this is just a thumbnail for today. Okay, I'm going to wind up in a couple of minutes. So this was the movement around brand awareness, which you can see the improvements as well as we went along the way. We had this target of 100,000 members. Now then, look at this for a graph. British Cycling is 55 years old, and for 48 of those, this was stuck at about 16,000. Beijing came along, we got a bit of a spike. We prepared for the Olympics, we got another spike. We had Team Sky and some profile on TV, we got another spike. The Olympics came, went through the roof. That is a crazy graph, but it's absolutely real. There's no sign of it slowing down. So all this leverage we're thinking about next year, exciting people, we're going to repeat this. It's going to happen again. Just in case we think we're just about what are called ordinary people getting into bike riding, we're looking after our talent. We've got some great ratios from our Go Ride talent scheme, local kids in local clubs. Brilliant in terms of how they progress. We've had investments in facilities, people believe in us, we deliver good events, and people invest in our facilities. We had a great year last year with Tour de France, 3 million people on the highway watching the event, and lots more of the properties coming through. That was a tour to Yorkshire, that's just a quick splash of some of the engagement in the media. We care about every cyclist, not just about racing, as I've mentioned. And these are some really. If you want to think about doing this well, here's a few clues. I'll be very happy to talk to you later today or any time you want to follow this up. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Presentations. Do we have any questions from the floor? I'm sure this talk must have inspired a lot. There is a question from on Twitter from a viewer from Zurich who is interested. How do you sustain what has been achieved given that organizing the games disbanded probably after the game? So how do you sustain this at the moment?
Well, the moment we still got Sky with us for another 18 months. Because we're in a better place in terms of our capability and the number of people in cycling, we've now built up a range of assets, and we're now talking to a range of other commercial sponsors. So we're kind of off the business for new sponsor interests, and that will be key because we've got so many assets that we didn't have 6 years ago. We're in a very good place to attract further investments, one thing. The other is our workforce has expanded, so we've got a bigger volunteer workforce. Some do a lot more than they used to, but also a lot of new people have come into it. I mentioned earlier that we've trained 3,500 people, indexing at about 50-50 in terms of male-female split. The staff at British Cycling have learned an awful lot, so there's a lot of efficiencies. Some of the business management processes are phenomenal. The data and the digital investment is still on the increase. And we're looking at new revenue streams as well. So it sounds a bit crude, but monetizing your customers, not in a commercial sense of getting money out of them, but seeing the value of different customers and leveraging more from that, be, you know, participation is your currency, fine, but more eyeballs in your sport means potentially more investment. Also the media, there's no sign of the media slowing down in terms of our interest, but I think a lot of this probably is underpinned by the fact that we need to continue our elite success, because the profile will dwindle if we don't get that. So to answer the question, spread your risk across funding partners, build your capacity with the workforce, and get some smart systems and people in your organisation, and build on the past and learn in the way I've talked about with the insight and so on that we've got in place.
Just sort of with the ability to look back now to 2008, 2009, when you took the decision to go on this journey, what do you think are sort of the key capabilities, strengths, behaviours or attitude traits of British Cycling that really enabled you to go for this? It might be sort of various for other MGBs that you've done to work on.
I think it's an ambition that turns heads. So if you don't have a big ambition, nobody really wants to galvanise behind something or whatever. So I think a big ambition, but not an ambition that's so far-fetched you could never achieve it. So the idea of doing a little bit of scanning about the reality of it, but still something that's pushing. So a big ambition, keeping things simple. So the proposition of elite success and participation rather than clutter the message. And then it's the campaigning. Really, it's what I've been saying. It's the campaigning, the ability to reach people and get them thinking about your activity and then designing a brilliant response. So it's the competences around that, really. I mean, everything we've done has been purposely designed. It's a bit like what Simon was saying, they've been in this talk, really. It doesn't sit there as a floppy activity and people are using it and we're not sure about it. It's like, is it working enough? No. Well, it has to change. And it has to change within the week. So we have a brilliant portal for all our volunteers, and they have their own kind of dashboard. And they report in all their activities. And if they have a near miss on an accident, but if they have a bit of poor customer service where they thought that wasn't the best we could do, we get the information on the Monday or Tuesday, and we have a customer service team, a specific customer service team that look after them, and we address it. So the next time that person comes back, we've all been there, haven't we? Your facilities weren't very good last week, the balancing hole was really slippy. And you come back next week and it's just as slippy as that. It's like, why? When we come. So it's things like that, reacting so quickly to the reaction from customers was probably one of the key things beyond the ability to campaign and reach people.
One more question, Andy.
Oh yeah, hi. I was just wondering whether the next challenge was to think about how we can use major events to deliver a better cycling infrastructure. To me, talking about the inspiration phase, that's an amazing success story.
Yeah. But
is there still a missed opportunity in terms of, I'm not talking about velodromes and elite infrastructure, I'm talking about road infrastructure, recreation, transport, and how do we use major events to actually deliver better facilities for cyclists?
Yeah, that's a really good point. We could talk for a long time about that. If you just think about the Tour de France coming to Britain, the treatment to the roads that the Yorkshire authorities put in place was phenomenal. I rode the route two days before the event. It was like a billiard table. It was absolutely brilliant. So maybe show the Tour de France every year around the whole UK. Not possible. What we're doing, we're talking to government about how they might rethink their transport spend. You know, typically, it's going to go on big highway projects, but there's a lot of subtleties around it and a new blueprint. We've got Chris Boardman, who's our policy advisor, and he's doing some great work to. He's quite pushy about it, but at the same time, he's taking people with him about the reality of if you change the infrastructure, you know, it's good for the nation on a whole range of fronts. So things like junction redesigns, we're looking at a campaign with the AA and other organisations. We're just exploring the idea of this mutual respect. So this respect between people who ride bikes and other road users, rather than this sort of, you know, for every bad car driver, there's a bad cyclist, really. So it's about getting people to understand that there's room on the road for both people. We do lots of international comparisons, and it's difficult because, you know, the conurbation density is different and the whole culture in this country is different. But we're only shy away from it. We need investment. We're pushing the government to consider, you know, highway authorities going from £2 a head spent on cycling, on road infrastructure, to £10 a head. That's where we're, so we're lobbying on that basis. And actually, cycling hasn't really got a home beyond velodromes and just a handful, really, of closed road circuits, which are typically 2 kilometre circuits that are traffic-free, typically for clubs and racing, and more so people want to get involved in riding now. We want a purpose-built cycling facility in every major town and city. That's our next aspiration. Because if you think about it, if you want to compete at athletics, you've got an athletics track. You've got track and field facilities. If you want to compete on a bike, in a bike race, yes, you can do it on the road, but also we're looking for purpose-built cycle circuits, which can be used not just for racing, but for other uses as well. And it's actually quite poor in this country in terms of purpose-built traffic-free facilities, so that's another part of the plan.
Well, I'm afraid we're running late on schedule, so let's break at this point. I have a 15-minute break, clean coffee is being served. So thank you very much, Stewart.
Thank you.
We will then continue.